Hello.
And Conor Mahood.
Aloha.
And today we are going to be talking about Blade Runner 2049. Finally, we're getting around to doing this. We've been talking about doing this for I don't know how long now, and it had to happen. And I suppose part of the delay is the I don't understand the European Blu-ray release delay between.
Yeah, it's like a full month, right?
It was a long time. Yeah, it was a long wait.
It seemed a little. I don't know. I mean, at this point, it's like if you can get a video game out the door the same day worldwide, like. Really a movie? I mean, come on, guys, really? I mean, oh, well, anyway. But yeah, so that's what we're going to be talking about today. To kind of kick us off, we're going to talk about how we felt about the original Blade Runner, what sort of brought us into the series, and I don't know, just something along those lines, sort of like we did with the Last Jedi podcast. So to kick us off, Connor, why don't you give us your thoughts on the original Blade Runner, kind of like how you felt about it, what it means to you today, and like then, basically.
Sure. I saw Blade Runner first when I was about 18. Mm-hmm. And I thought it was kind of boring, but good, but boring. Mm-hmm. And then I was like 20 and I was working in a bookstore and there was a book called Future Noir. And I picked it up just because it was called Future Noir. I was like, what's that? That sounds cool. And it was about the making of Blade Runner. It's by a guy called Paul M. Salmon. Okay. And I started reading it and it was so good that it's a big book and I read it cover to cover. I loved it so much. I read it cover to cover. And then I went and watched Blade Runner again. And then I've been, you know, it's been one of my top five movies since then. I sort of watch it every year or two. But yeah, so my first reaction to Blade Runner was that it was a little bit slow. And then later, the slowness is a huge part of what I love about it. And yeah, it's one of my favorite things. And a lot of things that I really like, I can't help but kind of measure them against Blade Runner. Even something like another one of my absolute favorite movies is the Fifth Element. And I love the way the Fifth Element almost feels like an optimistic, like daylight version of some of the looks of things in Blade Runner. You know, it feels like a response to Blade Runner in a way, even though it's, you know, influenced by all this other stuff like French comics and stuff. But yeah, so Blade Runner has been a big thing in my life. Yeah, I'm a huge fan.
Cool. John?
I had a very similar experience the first time watching Blade Runner as Connor did. It just took me about four or five more watches to turn around on it. And I never like thought I disliked the movie. I just couldn't decide if I liked it or not. At this point, I say I do like the movie. I think it's good, but it's saved for a few major issues I have with it. I don't think Deckard's a very good character in this Blade Runner, in the first one. I wish that they had followed Roy Batty and crew along more. I thought they were a more interesting part of the story than Deckard's investigation, which really wasn't much of an investigation since she knew where it was going the entire time, which always felt weird to me. Also, the love story is one of the worst in any classic movie I can think of. It's not very satisfying. Of course, not even the weird sexual assault scene aside, like it just didn't work for me. Mm-hmm. But I do love the direction of it. I love it. I mean, it's inspired a lot of things that I've liked. I've talked about off air about how much I like Cowboy Bebop. It's very inspired by Blade Runner. And so, yeah, I do think the first one's good. I just think it's flawed. That's all I got, I think.
Okay. I had this weird, like, I guess, three-step process with this movie. Where I saw it as a kid and I just thought it was kind of like aesthetically, just a cool sci-fi movie. Like I just kind of dug what was going on there, even though it was an incredibly small amount of action. Like I kind of dug it more for the action stuff. Like I thought like the fights were pretty well choreographed, and I just like enjoyed the really like heavy feeling of Deckard's gun.
I do love that. I don't think I've ever thought of Blade Runner as an action movie. Like there's
not.
Like,
well, I saw this as a child, so yeah, it was an action movie to me.
Yeah,
so.
Even like teenage me didn't like. Yeah.
Yeah. But, well, I'm talking single digits, so that's why. Yeah. So. Yeah. I was gonna say you'll forgive somebody who's I don't know 7 years old who sees this and thinks it's cool as an action movie. So.
Jason, I will decide who I will forgive and who I will not forgive.
No. Go on. This is my podcast, and I'll tell you who to forgive.
Yeah. Okay. Actually, that's reasonable. Yeah. Okay.
I don't know about reasonable. Seems more of a very Garnet Lee-ish, but anyway. there's and then like more in my teenage years, I sort of like kind of dug it more just for like what I felt it was bringing or what it sort of like headed up as far as like the sci-fi genre in general. Didn't really, it sort of was sort of bouncing off of me more as I got older, and I sort of felt, how to put it, I wasn't as keen on it as I was as a child, but I'm kind of more keen on it now as I've gotten older, and I appreciate it more for not only what it did, but just its sort of like different direction of storytelling. Trying to be noir and like sci-fi at the same time seemed a little tough. And sometimes you can be forgiven for almost forgetting this movie is a sci-fi movie to begin with. Like, it does, if you would put this thing in black and white, I think you could almost pass it off as like a 40s noir movie to a degree. Yeah. And that's kind of what I've appreciated about it. It's influenced a lot as it's, you know, as it's gotten older. John, you mentioned that off air where Cowboy Bebop was heavily influenced by Blade Runner. And I mean, so much sci-fi has been influenced by Blade Runner. Just that kind of dirty sci-fi feeling where I feel like Star Wars kind of did it to a point, but it's still, there was a lot of parts of it that felt pretty like sterile and clean. And it's not like we're, you know, Star Trek, as far as I guess storytelling and just character development is better. But it always has that, you know, squeaky clean future feel where Blade Runner just felt like, I don't know, it just felt lived in. And that's what I appreciated about it the most. I think it was just how lived in the world itself felt. And that's sort of what has kept me coming back to it every couple of years just to check it out, just as a reminder of like why I like this and why I feel it was so influential in a genre I adore. So
yeah, it has one of the best sci-fi worlds, even though it seems like I wouldn't want to live in. It's just like it's just so well realized the entire time. And I mean, even after things have aped it like to a T, like this, I watched Altered Carbon a little bit on Netflix recently. That's literally just Blade Runner is the entire world. It's really annoying in a way, just how blatantly Blade Runner it is. But yeah, even 40 years later, how long has it been? It's still being copied. It's
coming up on 40.
Yeah.
It's closer to 40 than 30 at this point. So.
Yeah.
So like, I think that what you're saying about how it's influenced all or a lot of sci-fi, I think once a movie becomes important enough in kind of the firmament, then everything has to either be influenced by it or be a response to it or something. It's like it can't be ignored. You know what I mean?
Right.
Like they have to at least have thought about Blade Runner while they were making X, Y, or Z. So like for me, there's a couple of things about Blade Runner. One, I love that it was shot on the same backlot as a lot of the old noir movies. Like it's like the old New York set.
Okay.
So actually like, you know, Humphrey Bogart, walk down the same streets, the same studio backlot streets, doing very similar stuff. And I also love that it was shot with available light. They didn't use traditional like movie lighting for Blade Runner. The movie is absolutely full of neon, and they use that neon and the other light sources that are on the screen are where the light is coming from. Everything that all the light that's in the camera has just come from what is on screen, which is crazy difficult to do.
That's fantastic.
It's an amazing achievement in Blade Runner that it works so well.
Yeah, the lighting in general in Blade Runner is fantastic. Gorgeous. It's so good. Like
I've always thought of Ridley Scott as like one of his things is like he's actually like a real master of light.
Oh yeah, he loves his fucking vent and fan light shots too. And I'm right there with him. You know, just like oscillating fan put with light in between it. Love it. can't get enough. It's a really little minor thing that I love it's like Alien. Blade Runner big time in both those movies. So
I don't want to keep us too long on Blade Runner, but if I can just say one more thing about Deckard as a character, I totally understand. Cause my reaction first was that I didn't really like him. And I thought that he wasn't really doing enough. And I didn't think he was a great. Now I'm glued to the screen whenever Deckard's on screen. That one shot where he takes a drink of whiskey and a little bit of blood comes from his mouth back into the whiskey glass, I think is like one of the coolest shots ever, you know, captured on film. But I think that Deckard is like kind of an existential hero, and he's grappling with all this kind of existential despair, which I think once I get on board with that, and that's the sort of feeling I have while I'm watching that character, I'm quite fascinated. But I do understand how as a detective story, you know, he's not doing a lot of the stuff that a detective should be doing in a detective story, or he's not doing it the same way anyway.
Yeah, I mean, there is obviously the cool scene where the enhanced scene when he's checking out the crime scene on that computer. It's a great
Esper. Love that machine. Yeah,
it's a great thing. I don't even know if I consider him a hero in the story at all. Honestly, he's just kind of another player in the story. That's how I've always seen it. I don't know. He never clicked with me in the first Blade Runner.
I think that.
as a protagonist, I guess.
I think he has an arc, you know. I don't think he's very heroic when we first meet him.
I think
he becomes heroic by the end, and I like that as an arc. But yeah, he's not particularly, and actually in the book he's a lot more compassionate in the book, and he's a lot kinder. But I think he's, you know, he's kind of an asshole, and he's kind of hardened. But some of the calcification around his heart sort of cracks as the movie goes on. So there we go. Okay, I've rabbited on about the original Blade Runner long enough.
All right.
No, I think giving context for this thing is sort of necessitated. Although it's weird that like Blade Runner 2049, it's completely standalone. I don't think you have to have any sort of familiarity with the first one to really enjoy this movie. Where like, you know, so many other sequels depend on your knowledge of that. But I think having, you know, like we've talked about, or like we mentioned, nearly 40 years between the two, you sort of have to you can't just assume somebody just saw this. This isn't something that came out, you know, the summer before last, so.
Yeah. Yeah, it's not relying on, like, really specific memory of all the plot points of the original. I think it does a really good job of, like, of sort of summoning up some of the feelings of the original without expecting you to remember every moment of it.
Right.
Yeah, I do think having knowledge of the first one makes it better. But yeah, I totally agree that you can go into this. Even if you don't like the first one, I think you can go into this one and still find things to enjoy.
It's sort of a pretty not standard bog thing at this point, but there's so much that, you know, maybe the original thing isn't as good as you'd want it to be, but adding, or, you know, watching to it will add to the experience of the second one. I kind of just sort of, you know, getting back to the anime thing, like I sort of felt like that with like the original Record of Lotus War OVA, and then going into, and I forget what the 26 episode series was called, is like something Night or something, but whatever. Having that first one, it really added to it. It just, watching that first one didn't do so much for me, even though it's kind of considered like a classic at this point, I suppose. I don't know. But I mean, that thing's probably getting on 20 something years by itself now. So by closer to 30 now that I think about it. But yeah, I just think that's sort of like standard fare at this point, where you don't need to have watched something to get enjoyment out of it. I mean, you can kind of dip right into any, you know, Fast and the Furious movie and kind of get the gist of it.
Yeah, I mean, I saw Terminator 2 before I saw Terminator 1 as a child.
Yeah,
so,
same here.
Yeah, and one's way more kid friendly than the other. Even though they're both very rated R.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah, that was a movie that I probably shouldn't have seen as young as I did. Just I got a little I was a little chicken shit as a child, and that. That was not a good movie to, like, you know, give to or have. Have a child who had frequent nightmares consume at in single digits. So it's like, yeah, okay, God, it's scary. But anyway,
Live next door to that robot factory, which didn't help.
Clearly that didn't help anything. You know, I'd sit there in the middle of the night and I'd be like, I wish that metal would not be so loud. Like, I wish they would learn to piece together that stuff a little bit more quietly. I mean, you know, sound dampening isn't what it is today. So it was like, you know,
it's just impressive they had a robot factory back in the 90s. Like, honestly. You know, in New Mexico. So,
yeah. It was a big hub of robot factories, actually. It shows what you know, buddy.
Yeah, exactly. New Mexico at that point, was cheap and the labor was cheap. So that's kind of what you did.
I'm a millennial. I don't pay attention to things in the past. So, you know.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Be sure to check out our game club on the 20 year old Metal Gear Solid.
that I adore.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
So, all right, let's move on to Blade Runner 2049. John, you were the biggest like salesman of this movie that I had kind of encountered. Sort of like I am the way for Tactics Ogre. So why don't you go ahead and I don't want to say take it away, but take it away with this movie here, because I mean, this was a big thing for you, and you got me to go to a theater by myself. And I'm a guy who goes to see a movie in the theater with his mom maybe once or twice a year, and this was like my fourth movie I saw in the theater that year. So
yeah, I saw the movies in theaters and walked out of it and immediately had to see it again. Like, and I thought to myself, actually, I'm going to go to sleep first and then I'm going to decide. And then I woke up and immediately was thinking about the movie again. And I saw it a week later in theaters the second time eventually. So yeah, I really like this movie. I've now seen it three times. it's hard for me to put my finger quite on what separates this one from the first one for me. Even just the large modern budget allows for building the world even more than the first one possibly ever could have. But I don't know. I think it might be Kay, honestly, that does it for me, even though he's like a very non-emotive character by design. I will defend that. He just works for me in a way that Decker never did. I feel like Kay is actually a protagonist, and his arc is more satisfying. It's very similar to Decker's arc, but he's a more sympathetic character. I find the replicant characters in the Blade Runner world in general more interesting than the human characters, because they actually have they're dealing with the struggles. So, yeah, it kind of felt like making Roy Batty the main character to me.
Yeah.
And I think that's in the end, that's what the glue that holds it all together for me. And there's a bunch of other things like joy and love, both characters. I am in love with for different reasons. And then of course this movie is gorgeous.
Yeah, it is beautifully shot.
I feel bad for people that aren't going to get to see it in theaters, because it does lose a little bit on a TV screen. No matter, even having a large TV screen, I think it loses a bit.
Oh no, no! You just sit on the floor, crane your neck up at about a foot away from it, and it's about the same experience.
Okay. There's so many things I want to talk about, but I feel like we'll get to it more naturally. I don't want to it's kind of just my quick feelings on what I like about that movie. What do you guys think about Kay as a character? He is the crux of this fucking movie. So
I absolutely adore Kay. He's just like, so I, if you've had the misfortune to hear the movie podcast that I do with Luke,
stop it.
I talk,
Luke is very good on that podcast. I won't have you besmirch his name.
Yeah. You're right. He is actually pretty good on that. But I talk all the time about this thing that I have with movies and TV and stuff, where I feel like every story, just for me as the viewer or the reader or whatever, every story is a series of turns or decisions. And if it continues to make all the right decisions or all the right turns, it can keep me right to the end. But a lot of the time I'll fall off halfway through or two thirds of the way through, because a decision just doesn't feel right, or a direction they took with a character, whatever. And Kay was like every tiny decision, every little micro turn for that character in this movie was perfect for me. I loved it. I loved what they did with him. I loved how he behaved. I loved how he was performed by Ryan Gosling. And I also think, I love what you said about how he's like ostensibly kind of not emotive, but actually he is the emotional core of the movie, which is fantastic. I think Kay is a fantastic protagonist. And yes, it is like the luxury of finally getting to see a whole movie about Roy Batty.
Yeah, and his like emotional arc, like his literal emotional arc in the movie is like the fact that he's so non-emotive for most of it makes the jolts of emotion he has when things finally just like snaps at times even more effective. Like there's the scene when he finds out a big secret, which we can talk about in a second, but when he thinks he finds something out is just I feel it every time it happens, every time he screams like in that scene. Oh my god, it's just like Ryan Gosling fucking kills it. I will say that he deserves more credit for people that he gets for this. I know he's doing the Ryan Gosling thing. He's doing the Drive thing too, but it worked.
Yeah.
That's perfectly.
Also, I don't give a fuck. And I find that particular type of criticism of an actor so incredibly fucking banal, because like Errol Flynn did an Errol Flynn thing all the time. Cary Grant did a Cary Grant thing all the time.
Yes.
And the reason, by the way, that they did this was because nobody else could do that specific thing
the
way they
did
it.
Right, you hire an actor not just because like, oh, well, let's put, you know, like, I guess you can do this. It's more of a, you're a good fit for this character, and what you bring will add to this character. So that's what I feel like they did, that was the best decision they did with this, was putting Gosling in here.
I also, I don't know, I just feel like Usain Bolt does an Usain Bolt thing when he's running.
Yeah.
Like, yes. That's not a fucking problem. I don't want him to run like Dustin Hoffman. You know what I mean? He doesn't have to run a different way to show me that he's a great runner.
That might be my favorite fucking analogy ever.
Hoffman, for the record, a very good runner. He runs really well in the marathon, man. But you know what I mean?
Yes, I do. I 100% agree.
Yeah, absolutely.
What do you think of Kay, Jason?
I feel the same way. I love the arc he went through where, you know, like I said, like you said, we'll dig into this a little bit more here in a minute, but like just the arc he went through of realization of what he is and then what he isn't, I suppose.
Yes.
Just my favorite thing about this movie. I really, really enjoyed that. And the, just from a sound design thing too, I mean, you know, this is sort of my thing with, you know, movies and video games in general is just like what they do with the sound. Outside of it being maybe just a hair too loud at times, I felt like maybe they could have toned down the mix just a hair. But like the very subtle additions of like some of the original or some of the music from the original Blade Runner, I really felt was
gorgeous.
Just incredibly well done. And as a guy who's not a particular fan of the soundtrack of the original Blade Runner,
I am.
What I felt they did was very good to add to the more, I guess, orchestral. It was Hans Zimmer that did this one?
Yes, Hans Zimmer. Yeah. It was going to be, I forget who originally was going to do it, but yeah, Hans Zimmer came in and finished it, I believe.
I think he completely nailed the soundtrack. I absolutely adore
it. It's an incredible job.
Yeah, like, and it's because the movie is so minimal in a lot of ways, even though it's so huge. Like, and the soundtrack is a really good example of that. And like at times, there's no music whatsoever almost. And then like when the timing of like even the simple use of bass and the timing of that at times is just fantastic. Just during like the walk to Vegas, walk through Vegas is incredible. Just sound design wise, because it's like there's no dialogue whatsoever. It's all built around sound and tracking of long shots. But it's. Yeah, I 100% the soundtrack. Other than in the theater for sure, it's a little much at times, and especially if the theater didn't have a particularly good sound system. But
a point on the sort of recurring themes from the old movie in terms of music is like, you know, it's like a they say your sense of smell is the biggest key, but also music is like a huge key to the power of memory, to the power of recall. Mm-hmm. And I think like both movies are obviously, you know, one of the main themes of Blade Runner is memory, you know, versus live experience, or like what memory means and, you know, how memory shapes you. And I think that it's a lovely like kind of play on that theme by having those musical themes come up, because they feel like that sort of, you know, the way they stimulate your memory feels like very in theme of that universe.
So I want to talk about totally switching gears here. I want to talk about Joy. I am a big fan of the relationship between Joy and Kay in this movie, because it is incredibly open to interpretation by the end of how you view his love with this AI. Wonderfully performed by Ana de Armas. I've never seen her in anything before. So, and I guess she was in the Jonah Hill comedy, I forget, it's like they're selling guns. Anyway, I didn't see that.
Same.
But she is an AI that Kay owns, and she is essentially his wife. It's her programming. And throughout the movie, she comes across as incredibly real. Even when they use instances to remind you that she's AI, like when he gets a phone call during a romantic moment on the roof. And also they do a lot of cool things visually with her too, just how she appears behind him and like goes through his body to see what he's doing. And also the sex scene with the prostitute, I guess she's a prostitute, I'm assuming, sex worker.
Except the vernacular these days.
Yes, sex worker. But a lot of what I like about it is like the interpretation part of it is that throughout, also you're reminded in just the world itself that Joy is a AI, and they're all called Joy when they're purchased.
Mm-hmm.
And so the question in the end is, and it's a big, like, choice is also a big theme in this, just like a lot of cyberpunk stuff involving androids and or replicants or anything of the sort. The power of choice is a big thing, because that's what makes us human. And it's kind of like, I interpret it as in the end that Kay does not care, and that his joy was his, and that she really did care about him. I've had long discussions with friends that, like, when we walked out of theater, that they took the instance where he walks up and on the bridge and sees the giant pink anime-ish looking Joy, that she was basic. It was fake the entire time. It didn't mean anything. But I always took it as it means as much as you want it to mean. So that's why I find it so powerful, because she meant something to him in the end. So that, and he, and her in particular, not the new one that he's looking at in front of him. I took him getting angry as him remembering that his joy was taken from him when love killed her.
Yeah.
So
absolutely.
Like, yeah, I really like that relationship personally.
And it echoes his own arc. Like, she is as mass produced as he is. They're both products.
Yeah, and it's hard to put into words that it's because it's gonna be so visual, but I believe her the whole time, and I know that she's designed that way.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
but and I truly believe everything she says she means, because AI has its own intelligence too, so. But I don't know, Jason, how do you feel about that relationship?
Yeah, see, that's the thing. I really enjoyed how Joy came across with that. And just that reminder that she isn't real and the joy that you have is your joy. I mean, it kind of reminds me, forgive me for, like, you know, going back this far into, like, you know, maybe all of our paths or our pasts. But, like, you know, that stuffed animal you had there, you could see 600 of them on the shelf, but the one you have is yours.
Yeah.
And that's what, you know, it's a weird, like, sort of like, I don't want to say it's like a statement on consumerism to a point either, but, you know, the thing that you have is yours, and it's special from every other one of them that is out there because it is yours. And just Kay's emotion is real for it. Whether or not Joy's actually is, he does feel like it is. And that's sort of the thing I like about that too, is where Joy's, you know, her programming is completely believable in this, you know, work of fiction. So it's like a double layer of fakeness that, and you still kind of come across, or it still comes across as, like, you know, real, which I think is a hard thing to pull off a lot of the times. You get, oh God, I'm trying to think, what was the AI's name in Mass Effect? God.
Oh, Eevee.
Eevee. Okay. I thought it was Eevee, but I was like, man, that can't be. I kind of got Pokemon on the brain, so I was like, I can't be right. So, but
Edie.
Yeah, like,
Edie.
You know, like,
Edie. Oh yeah, Edie.
Edie. Oh, okay.
Edie.
Okay.
Yeah.
So, he's right. Edie.
Okay. Cool. Yeah. Okay. But yeah, like Edie didn't. I don't know. Like, it. There was a layer there that just never let Edie feel real. Like, as an AI, I suppose. Like, it was. She always felt like she was supposed to be a character and not an AI. Pretending to be a character to somebody. And that's where I think Joy's, like, strongest suit is this joy. Kay's joy was very real to Kay. It doesn't matter that, you know, Joy is mass produced and will react this way if you start emotionally attaching to or kind of pushing Joy in that way. She'll react to that and adjust her programming, however you want to word it, accordingly to you. And that's, like I said, for me, that was a big deal for Joy. I really, really kind of dug how they handled her.
So personally, I don't take it that Joy is just, like, really well programmed, because they're both essentially products of the same corporation. Mm-hmm. But she encourages him to transgress against that corporation. So if she was purely behaving based on her programming, that wouldn't be possible. She's constantly sort of pushing him to transcend his limits. And interestingly, it feels like she's transcending her own limits before he is. So that, to me, that's what makes it feel real.
Yeah, and again, she's also one of the coolest visual things in the entire movie. It's like so really cool. There's a lot of clever uses of her in the entire throughout, and it's it's kind of like what this movie does well too is expanding like that the Blade Runner technology, because it feels like cyberpunk technology in movies and shows is always kind of similar, and I felt like this movie had a lot of interesting ideas and it expanded upon them really well. And she, I think, is like the prime example in my mind of all that cool stuff. Like that, I mean, that sex scene is a hell of a scene.
Yeah,
I think it's horrible. Like, it reminded me of the I was thinking while I was watching it that it's a contender with the movie Shame for most depressing three-way in Hollywood film, because it's horrible. Like, it's you understand what she's trying to do, but it's awful. And I think that's great that it's so awful, because it's like it's fucking complicated, you know, and it's sad and it's poignant and it's brilliant.
And I appreciate how Kay didn't even want to do it at first. He's like,
it's
like just, those subtle little things like him. Yeah. It's a powerful scene. Yeah. And very sad. Like a lot of things this movie are.
Yeah.
So,
yeah, I feel the same way about that scene. I just, I think I was expecting it to sync up at some point, and I'm just so happy they just never, like, you know, completely synced up. I think that was a very strong choice
for them to do.
So.
Yeah, because it always reminded you that there was an AI right there with them. It's mm-hmm. like, in that they're different people, or because her hands are moving differently than the other girl's hands are. And so, yeah, it's... okay. What next?
So evaluating this, you can evaluate this a bit more as an action movie than the previous one.
Yeah, for sure.
I think it holds up really well. I think it's a great action movie. You know, within the within those boundaries, like it's actually really it works really well. All the actions it was really thrilling.
It's a really quick burst of violent action in this movie. Like it's not, none of it lasts very long, but it's all very effective.
Talk about something I missed effective wise the first time was just how badly Love killed Coco. Holy God.
Oh yeah. She like, his upper jaw is like displaced. Like uh-huh. And she comes up behind him like, they do a good job of highlighting the movie, just how strong and reactive the replicants are and just how more effective they are than we are. Because I mean, Love hits him in the back of the head once, like basically sends his upper jaw almost through his mouth.
Yeah.
And Kay murders multiple people within like seconds, just because he's with a handgun. He also snaps that guy's spine over his fucking leg.
He runs through a wall.
Yeah, like that opening scene with Dave Bautista, mm-hmm. a former wrestler, now actor, who's actually been quite successful so far in acting.
I like him as an actor. I think he's got charisma. Yeah. He's got watchability. Yeah. I think he's really good, actually.
Yeah, I'm so sorry. I did not expect him to be as good as he is, but in this, like that opening scene, it's very effective. Like it's especially just the way it's shot and lighting, just like as he walks into the house and Kay's sitting off to the side with his in the shadows and with the soup bubbling in the background, a lot of good stuff there. And of course the slow build towards, something's about to pop off. And when he starts beating him through the wall.
Let me just kind of compliment that. They did a perfect job of giving that just enough time to like give you a sense of like how thick and sturdy that wall is and how hard it's being hit without dragging it into the ground. Like I think two more hits and that would have been like, okay, I get it. Any less, it would have been like, okay, that didn't impact, you know, for want of a better word there as much as it should have. They chose the amount of hits there perfectly. And I think it speaks a lot to how good of an action movie this is too. Like, I mean, this is something that, when my son's a little older, you know, I could just sit down and watch with him and he, you know, same thing with Blade Runner and like the different stages or the original Blade Runner and the different stages of my life. I can appreciate it for different things basically. And I think this will be something that, Thomas will get, different things out of as he gets older.
also at that point, you don't necessarily know Cade's a replicant. I don't think they've said anything about that yet. So he immediately gets beaten through a wall. I mean, you obviously got an idea of going into it, but they don't say anything about him being a replicant until afterwards. So that's like, I think my dad saw it too, because I talked him into going to seeing it. And he was like, he was in the disbelief state when he was getting beaten through a wall, because he didn't know he was a replicant. So he was like, "Oh, okay, cool. Whatever." Yeah. So he had that moment in the movie, but yeah. And also, the scene highlights just how hard it is to tell replicants apart. It's literally just the serial number under an eye. It's the only way you can tell. The only way you can officially decide whether someone's a replicant or not. Yeah. And just how similar to human beings they are, which is another big theme. That's why at least the Nexus 8s, the Ryan Gosling model, the K model, whatever their model's called, are a little easier to tell, apparently, because I think they lack emotion compared to humans.
There's all that baseline stuff.
Yeah, the baseline stuff. So
I love the way, I don't know about you guys if you had this feeling or not, but the fight with Dave Bautista kind of reminded me a little bit of the fight with Leon in the original Blade Runner.
Okay.
Leon is like the one who's not super smart, but he's really big and strong.
Yeah.
And it was kind of an interesting kind of contrast, because Leon obviously just picked up Deckard and threw him around and Deckard had no chance. Whereas with this, it's like Ryan Gosling is like a fit, normal-sized human versus a giant in the form of Dave Bautista. And it was kind of chilling, actually, because at this point, we don't feel like Ryan Gosling is particularly the good guy. He doesn't seem particularly heroic. It's quite chilling watching him kill this giant man. It's scary and it's spooky.
Yeah, because he's like punching him in the... He's like... Dave Bautista's having trouble breathing, too. Like, he's punching him in the throat. It's like... It's a brutal scene. Yeah. And... Then he pops two in him at the end when he tries to walk towards him, because he's not going in. He's like, "You're gonna kill me." So yeah, it's a effective way to open that movie. I did not expect it to open that way, which I guess I should have, because the first one opens in a similar sort of violent way. But
I love how it just feels really tragic. I also think, you know, the way he like puts his gun down on the table.
Yeah.
Okay, there's some chance that it might diffuse the situation, but also I think it speaks to something really horrible of, he just knows that he's a much stronger model and he doesn't need the gun. And all of the apparent advantage, the size advantage that Dave Bautista's character has, it doesn't really mean anything, because he's just a Nexus 8, whereas Kay is one of the new Wallace models and he's tougher and stronger. He doesn't need the gun. That's awful. In a great way.
You want to talk about Neander Wallace? Speaking of Wallace,
I used to like Jared Leto.
Oh, good, good. We're on the same page.
It's a really good start to this conversation. Okay. All right, yeah, I did. Too.
And then, I was like, over time, I was like, sometimes whatever.
I like his performances. I don't know if I ever liked Jared Leto, but yes.
I've never been in an elevator with him. I'm just talking about his performances. But like,
I think we can say when we like somebody in this context, we can just assume he's like the characters he played.
But like the Joker, I feel like that's like one of the worst. That's one of the worst paid acting jobs I've ever seen.
Wow, you know,
Suicide Squad's a bad fucking movie.
I could not bring myself to ever watch that. So
it could have been fun. It had things going for it. It had certain aspects going for it.
It was bad. It's just bad. It's not.
Yeah, I mean, look, it doesn't really work. But my point anyway is, I actually hated his performance in Suicide Squad so much that I sort of retroactively demoted him as an actor in my mind. And then I was like dreading having to watch him in this. And if I can pay him the greatest possible compliment I can spare him, he was fine.
He chews up scenery in this movie. Oh man.
I don't necessarily mean
that in a bad way either. He is an interesting character. He has the most blatant God complex, I see in a while in a movie. Like, it literally, like, he literally,
it's not even a cop.
Yeah, yeah, it's no. Literally thinks he's God. So,
yeah, like, it's so, yeah, yeah.
That would be like saying Napoleon had a Napoleonic complex.
And,
it's like, no,
and it's like, he talks only in scripture, I feel like, basically, yeah. His own scripture, his own version of scripture. So,
that's true. He does behave like an Old Testament, like, he's like Yahweh, basically. I thought his voice was really good, actually. I thought his voice sounded great. His voice had a lot of gravitas, and that was kind of cool.
Yeah, he did. It was like non emotive and emotive. It was an interesting choice voice wise, and his like the way he would increase his inflection on stuff was interesting too. I think I like his character, but it's complicated. His scenes are it's him in all the scenes talking most of the time. So any scene he's in, he's only the one talking. He's the only one talking most of the time.
Which also kind of inflects on his character, where he will speak and not be spoken to.
Yeah, yes, he's not a listener.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, he is above everyone in his own mind, naturally. So he refers to replicants as his angels, his children, or yet he does not see them as anything more than slaves. His goal is to, cause he's like, they have reached 9 planets, but he can count 9 on, you can count 9 on
a child
fingers.
Can count 9 on their fingers.
Yeah. 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 He wants to expand across the stars, and he needs, slave labor to do it in his mind, which.
Yeah. What was that? What was the wording? I think, humanity lost its taste for slave labor.
Yeah. Lost its stomach for it.
Yeah, its stomach.
Specifically stomach. Yeah, because the idea is that it's weakness, not taste. It's weakness that made people stop enslaving each other. Yeah.
There's a character flaw I'm glad we've largely grown out of.
My stomach for that is long gone. Or never there, really. So, he's kind of like, his goals kind of create the crux of the plot, I guess, in a way, or at least the bare bones of the plot, that there is a replicant child out there, Deckard's and Rachel's child, and he wants that so he can figure out how to, because Tyrell figured out reproduction in replicants, and he wants that because he can only make so many. If they could make each other, it would go faster. And it also highlights their differing goals, like Tyrell, he wanted them, what led to his downfall was because he kept making them more and more human, which was his end goal. Wallace wants slave labor. So it's kind of like the differing philosophies of the two corporations. Wallace's, he's not dead. So his seems to be, I guess, working out better than Tyrell's did. And I don't know which one's darker. Is like making them more human darker or not, or the other way darker?
I don't know, because he's like, Tyrell gives them sort of the ability to understand how awful their situation is.
Yeah.
And gives them like a 4-year lifespan. And then Wallace, like, I think sort of unintentionally gives them the same facilities, but he doesn't intend to. But he gives them the chance basically to live for, as far as we know, an open-ended amount of time in slavery, which is like an unending nightmare, which is like hell, basically.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. Is it going to be better to realize that your lifespan is short and you kind of just sort of have to grasp it? It doesn't really matter what your life is because it's going to end very shortly. Or is it okay that you have some sort of, you know, a bit less of, I suppose, consciousness about things, but you're sort of got enough of it to realize you're sort of in your role for as long as you're functioning. It's like, which is the worst, the hell to sift through.
Yeah. It's a interesting question. It's a fucked up question.
Yeah.
So
think it's a question that really has got an answer. And that's
kind of
something I really like about this movie.
That's kind of like
so much that doesn't get answered.
every question in the movie is like left up to your own interpretation, which is what I love, which is what I want in movies. I don't want to be told the answer to anything. It's like, leave it up to the audience to make their own decision based on it. And I think that leads to more interesting conversations afterwards like this, because, mm-hmm. and it's also not, you're not telling someone the right and wrong. You're just kind of giving them a situation and saying, what do you think? So it's complex. That's what it is. It's complexity. And I love that. So, and then, Neander's right-hand woman, Love, is the muscle of this, in this movie, essentially. I like her character a lot. I like what they do with her character. From her humble introduction as doing a deal with a lady over selling some replicants, to her getting her nails tattooed or whatever they were doing to her nails while she's shooting satellites down to protect Kay, who's getting attacked by the people out, the residents of San Diego.
Fucking San Diego, man.
San Diego. They deserved it.
And
like, I've seen the numbers. We don't have any listeners in San Diego, so right on.
Yeah, fuck you, San Diego.
She's like, I know she murders all the guys, and he looks at me and goes, do your fucking job, find the child. She's great. And she also, her bursts of emotion are fantastic too. Like her and Robin Wright's character, the madam of the police station, their interaction is very good in my, and her slowly just getting more and more angry and like crushing her hand, Robin's hand in her, I forget what Robin the character's actual name is. The madam.
Lieutenant Joshi? Yeah.
That sounds right. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
He just calls her ma'am or madam, right?
Madam. Yeah. 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 And just going, I'm going to tell him you tried to shoot me. And then stabbing her. And then using your face and then letting it drop on the desk is a really
casual.
It's a really good gag that they I think they give just enough time to without feeling like it's out of place. Like it's she's great. She's I don't know what you guys think. I loved her whole thing she's got going on.
Definitely.
That wasn't a pun. Anyway, yes, keep going.
Yeah, she's so gleeful. Like I really enjoy like a gleeful villain. She's fantastic. I also love the first time you see her with Wallace. She seems terrified of him.
Yeah, just him speaking terrifies her. Like he's not really doing anything to her. He's just talking and she is terrified.
Yeah. Even though she has the ability to, you know, break him 1500 ways from tomorrow, you know, it's like,
yeah.
Yeah.
Doesn't blink or whatever. I don't know.
Yeah.
Yeah. And like one of the shorts actually explains that they put out the webisodes that they put out, and how in control Neander is of these replicants.
Ugh.
He commands one to, as a demonstration. He says, kill me or kill yourself. You decide. And he then kills itself instead of killing. So they are very, very subjugated, especially to him, to God, essentially.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
So, yeah, she's. I also love a good villain that you want to get their comeuppance. Like she is.
She
when she kills Joy, and you're just like, oh, he's gonna fucking kill you, and lo and behold, you fucking drowns her in a really cool scene, in a really cool action scene, also at the end of the movie.
Yeah, the fight is crazy. It looks amazing.
Yeah. Yeah, just the whole, like, the dam, the water all over the place, the rain, the fact that they're trying not to drown while they're fighting. So, and the soundtrack's great, too. Yeah, good stuff. What do you think, Jason? You like Love?
I don't think I was... Let's just get over this whole, this isn't a pun thing. If we say love and love in the same thing, I'm not as in love with Love as you guys are, but I did enjoy her quite a bit. she, like I said, she bounced off me a little bit more than you guys did, clearly, but I still enjoyed what she was. And like you said, I don't think I caught the first time I watched this, that scene where she's absolutely terrified of him and just like, you know, just like I said, maybe it was just something I caught in a little bit more of a subtle situation where I could kind of like put it together a little bit more slowly and at my own pace, largely because, you know, I've got every, you know, 3 minutes a kid asking me to stop the movie so they can get, yeah. I can get them something and I have to pause it. And then I sit down and like, oh, that facial expression I didn't recognize the first time. So, but yeah, I really dug what she was and just how calloused I think she is about everything outside of her fear of her master, I suppose we'll go with that.
Okay. Yes. Mr. Wallace himself.
Yeah. She just reminds me of a seasoned veteran who, like, you know, you just give them the job to do and they just do it. It's like, this is going to happen. It doesn't really matter what you throw at me. It's going to happen. So that's just kind of where ended up with her. And like I said, I dig that. It just wasn't as, it didn't mean as much to me, I suppose.
Yeah. I guess I just like having a clear cut, you know, villain in the movie. Even like Neander's obviously the big villain, but he's not going to leave his castle, his factory. So, I do want to talk about my favorite sequence in the movie. Just the whole Las Vegas sequence is my favorite from beginning to end, I'd say. I don't know if you guys have different ones you want to talk about, but I love everything about it. I love the set design. I love the constant bright orange throughout it, mm-hmm. and from the radiation. I love his slow walk through Vegas as he finds the signs of life in there, and he finds like the beehive and just the slow walk. There's not a lot of music playing. Like there's occasional bursts of bass as he comes across things, but mostly it's just Kay walking around looking, and it's very lingering, which is something I really love about this movie, is the way it lingers on long shots, just to give the viewer time to take everything in and think about everything. Mm-hmm. Some people are not going to like that naturally. It's going to feel too slow, and I don't think that's the wrong opinion. I just think it's up to taste at that point. But wow. And then I wish they had not revealed Deckard was in the movie beforehand. That would have made that moment better. It's still good, him slowly coming out of the shadows, quoting some scripture, and then their fight through the club. I forget what they're actually called now. With all the different holograms bursting up back and forth constantly.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, my God. That fight scene is, it's my everything.
Fantastic.
It's just the burst of music and light and them, just this old Deckard trying to fight Kay the entire time.
Yeah, that's, that is really great. Like, just that whole thing of, like, not really trying to make Deckard, like, a badass by getting him a stunt double or whatever, just showing that, like, no, he's kind of a feeble old man at this point and he doesn't stand a chance.
Yeah, and Kay's like, I don't want to hurt you, but you're making this really fucking hard, man. Come on. It's like, I don't think
he seems feeble, though. Those, like, those punches look pretty good to me.
Yeah.
He's punching Kay, unfortunately.
I suppose comparatively feeble, you know?
Yeah.
I mean,
yeah,
granted, I'm you know, 35 and in relatively good shape, and I don't think there would be a very long fight there. That would be a pretty much one and done. I would turn into Coco there with love. So,
yeah, and eventually he just gets tired enough. He's like, can we just go? He's like, you want to get a drink? He's just so tired.
He's just like, okay, yeah, I tried. Yeah. Fuck it. And I think this is like one instance where I think Harrison Ford's acting, I guess, really kind of not his acting in this movie, but just his acting in general sort of like came across pretty well, where, you know, he kind of comes across as like old and crotchety these days. And I think that really did well in this movie.
Yeah, I like old crotchety Deckard more than I liked young Deckard in Blade Runner. Like I enjoy Harrison Ford in the movie quite a bit. And yeah, it all works for me. It's basically just Harrison Ford being Harrison Ford. But I mean, like we talked about earlier, that's totally fine with me.
Yeah.
So,
yeah.
Yeah. And their discussion at the bar is really good. Like their whole interaction there is wonderful.
Excellent.
It's
so loaded.
Yeah. Oh. There's There's so much tension because it's so much tension there, especially if you have not seen the movie before, because it's, at this point you're like, Kay is his son and he doesn't know that. And Kay's trying to figure out the right way to say this to him.
Yeah. It's heartbreaking.
Just like the way he like stares at him for long periods of time, just trying to figure out what to say is like, and he's like, and his first question was like, what was she like? You know, like, what was my mom like? Is what his first question is what he's essentially asking. Or what was her name? Sorry. Yeah. And it's just hard because even when you know, like after seeing it the first time, you know what happens. It's still just as hard because you're like, he doesn't know still. he thought he's figured it out.
And he hasn't. Yeah. So.
Like the tension turns to tragic irony, right? Like the first time you see it, it's tension, and then the second time, you know something really awful and really sad that Kay doesn't know, mm-hmm. and that's tragic irony. That's really powerful.
Yeah.
Yeah. He goes. He does that. Here's the stranger's thing, and it's very good.
If I could jump ahead of you on this one, Connor, because mine's really quick. It's not really a scene so much as a thing in the movie, and it is the baseline test. They do a wonderful job, I think, of giving you just enough information as to like what is going on here without actually like laying it out there and telling you what is going on, because you know, having watched that, there are those scenes, how many total are there in the movie? Two, right?
Baseline scenes. Yeah, there's two.
So that's like, you know, so having watched those like four times, all total, it's like, I still am not 100% sure is like what exactly they're looking for when they're doing this. And I love that they left it ambiguous enough that they feel confident enough in what they do that this is a cool bit of world building, but we don't need to explain it. You'll just enjoy what is there. And it's a moment that you will be able to kind of take further down and just leave in your mind as something just not important, but you know, adds to what's going on in the movie in general.
Yeah, and I love that the first time they do it, like, I was like, what the fuck is going on? Because they're just, like, rapid-fire questioning him, and it's like, what the fuck is going on? And he's just repeating what he's saying sometimes, like, word for word or not. And then, but, like, Ryan Gosling in the second scene, like, just from the way he reacts to certain questions, you can tell something wrong with him, mm-hmm. like, just by that. And it's like, even without knowing that, like, he reacts differently in the second baseline test and he does the first one, and that's all you really need to know. You don't even need to know what exactly is the key. Is it just that he is hesitating for repeating? Is it something in his eyes? Simply just shots of Ryan Gosling's face and his slight different delivery of lines is all you need to understand that he is not on whatever they consider baseline.
Yeah, exactly. So how about you, Connor? What's your favorite thing in this movie?
You know, one really small thing that I thought was pretty amazing and kind of cool was when he's just killed Dave Bautista and he comes to the police station to make his report. He's walking down the corridor and a uniformed officer says something like, fuck you, skin job, or fuck off, skin job.
Yeah.
While they're passing each other in the corridor. And not only does he not react, but he then sort of he casts his eyes downward.
Yes.
And he walks kind of so slightly.
Yeah. And then he continues that as he walks down the corridor and he's like hiding his eyes as if he's like not allowed to meet their gaze. And that's so fucking brilliant. And it's so shocking and it's so horrible. And it's a great punch in the gut. And at that point, you don't know much about Kay, but you know everything, really. It's brilliant.
That's
my favorite thing.
Yeah, I really love that thing. I think the second thing they do, like the fuck off skin job on his door, or Skinner, whatever they say, is too on the nose for me personally.
It feels thematically correct with this world.
Yeah, like they would definitely that would definitely happen. I don't know. I was like,
okay, I dig what you're saying, but I also think it makes us it doesn't just repeat the point from the police station. It makes a new point. Because the people in the police station, right, they're cops, they're in a position of power or whatever. But that apartment building that he lives in is obviously just some shitty place, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And the people that live there are not at the top of society, but they're humans, and that means they are way above him. And even though right to his face they could write that on his door, he wouldn't be able to retaliate. Even though he has all this power, he's powerless. So I think it makes a new...
acknowledge it. Like he doesn't have any... It's like that just... Like he's not designed to acknowledge it, basically. Mm-hmm. Like it's just kind of how it is. So yeah. I do agree with that. I think it's just writing on doors and stuff has done a lot of things. I don't know. It's
no, tragically, it's just what people do, though.
Yeah.
Like
yeah.
It's what people like here in this day and age, right now, all the fucking time. That's what people do. It's horrible, but it's one of the simplest and truest things about prejudice. People write shit on your door.
Yeah. It's the easiest way to convey your point in real life, and kind of does that very well in this movie too. I think like you said, Connor, it says exactly what you were saying, and just without actually having to, like I said, you know, ram it down your throat. And that's, I think, thematically just something in this movie where it just does it so marvelously well. It's not, I don't want to say so much better than the original Blade Runner, but does it very well. And just like I said, just the subtleness, even though this one does seem to come at you a little bit harder than the first one, just how it brings like its message to the forefront, like very subtly. It never jams it down your throat. I adore that.
Yeah. I mean, like the replicants are figures of fear and wonder in mm-hmm. Blade Runner. And replicants are figures of contempt in Blade Runner 2049.
Yeah. Because
I think that's an interesting contrast.
Yeah. Cause they're slaves now instead of other people. So it's just, you know, further highlighting the themes, the difference in themes between the two movies. Okay. I think a few other things you want to talk about, I think it's time to talk about Kay's arc. Is Kay, what happens to Kay in this movie?
We should do that and use this as kind of a wrap up point since this is sort of Kay's movie.
Yeah.
So
yeah, that's good. It's kind of what this whole movie is built around. We've kind of talked around it here and there, but so when Kay goes back to investigate, you know, and he finds out that the date on the tree is similar to a date from a thing in his memory, it starts him down the rabbit hole of, is he the replicant child that they're looking for? And the movie is very good at putting the pieces out there for you, but also basically telling you he's not, if you just paid attention a little closer to what characters say to him at times. Especially in the scene when he goes to meet Dr. Stellan, the memory creator.
This really happened. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah.
Not like this is real or this is your memory or this happened to you. Yeah, that's awful. It's really sad.
Two different words adding to the end of that sentence would have changed the entire meaning of that. If she had said, you know, mm-hmm. this really happened to you, that would have changed that entirely. But just the, you know, leaving that out just is like, okay, well, yeah.
Yeah, and it's like the first time you see that scene. Also, the memory stuff is super cool. Like what they do with that. Oh, my God. That's little tool she has. That's great. It's like the little thing she did with the bug at the beginning, too.
Yeah, it's gorgeous.
Yeah. Yeah. It's and she's great she's a very sad character, just trying to hold it all together the entire time she's on the scene. Like there is so much sadness behind everything she's saying, because like she describes that her parent, like what happened with her parents is that they gave her everything except for being around, basically. So yeah, like because
everything you can want but them.
Yeah, and or the fact that they got everything except for crowds. I was so used to being around crowds, and then that's the last thing that she says before they move into the next thing. And it's such a sad thing, like there are no people there, it's just her, and it's just so
bleak.
Yeah, it's and she's there making people try for giving memories to things, you know, to make them happier or more human is what they are for the replicants. So because memories define us and create and help form us and help keep us level. But and he she show Kay shows has her look at the memory and his strongest memory and him having that wooden horse with the date on it and being attacked by kids and whatnot. that he later finds at the same he later finds the orphanage, which is a shithole. God damn. Yeah, but
it's
rough. Very Dickens-esque on that one.
Yeah.
Yes, very Dickens-esque. And you guys said, she looks at it and she immediately recognizes it, and then she starts crying a little bit, and she's like, "Yes, this really happened." Because she doesn't know why he's asking about it, I guess. I would assume she doesn't really know why he's asking about that memory.
I don't know. That's definitely a question I think is left open.
Yeah, I guess she might have an idea of it after seeing it, but what really makes that scene, like, her reaction is great, but Kay, to this point, there was a scene when he finds the horse in the orphanage, there, like, they linger on his hands holding the horse too, when he's looking at it to find the date, and his hands are like shaking very subtly, which I love. Like, they don't show his face, they just show his hand shaking a little bit, just to show what's going through his mind as he's like turning this thing over. And they linger on his face for a long shot there, and he almost breaks, but not quite. But this is the moment when she goes, "This actually happened," and he just screams, "God damn it!" and kicks the chair over, and leaves. It's just like, it's so powerful because he hadn't really emoted up to that point at all. Like, he kept it all in, like he's supposed to, and that just broke. He's like, he can't do it anymore. All the fact that he thinks he has parents. He thinks also the line early in the movie, like, to be born is to have a soul, is what he believes. Yeah. So he thinks, like, and even though Robin Wright's character tries to console him in her own way.
No, she doesn't. I don't think she's even trying to console him. I think she's just saying, like, forget that. That's, you don't deserve that kind of level of autonomy. She's like,
I was going to say, to me it came across like she was just like, it would be like the printer, telling you, like, have a good day. It's like, you don't really mean that. You're just, whatever.
I don't know. She said you're doing fine without one. I don't know. She's like,
the way she delivered it, it seemed very like brushing it off to me.
For me, it sounded like she was saying, you don't have a soul. Shut the fuck up about a soul and do your fucking job, which you've been doing fine at up to now. No, but you might not continue.
She had dismissed him already, and then she said that line. She said that after the fact. To me, that came off.
It's interesting. I think it's cool that we can have different interpretations of it. Actually, I think that's a good example of where, like, maybe it is left a bit open. Then,
because I do think she cares about Kay in her own way.
I don't.
I don't either. I think she thinks of him as a tool. Like, hey, that's a good printer.
Mm-hmm. I mean, she tries to protect him multiple times. Like, she dies because she doesn't want to tell her where he is.
Yeah.
So, and she gives him the 48 hours, So.
Yeah.
She's also using him as a tool, of course, to kill this child. So there's that too. So there are layers to it. But I do think, in her own way, she does care about Kay to an extent. So, as much as a boss could care about an employee. I totally see where you guys are coming from. I just interpreted that line, the way it was delivered and the timing of the delivery, as her trying in a way to make him feel a little better. After Deckard gets taken by Love, when they come in and she kills Joy, and also the scene is a really subtle way to show that Deckard's a replicant, I believe. This whole thing, other than the fact he lives in Vegas, is like, when the humans come in, they have masks on to breathe in the radiation, and he never has a mask on. Now that it's Kay or Love.
Yeah.
So I think they never straight out say he's a replicant, I believe. I think there's also a line where Love says, "We're going back to see our father," when they're going back, when she thinks she kills Kay.
Well, a couple of things. One, he wouldn't be Deckard's father, because Terrell made Deckard if Deckard was
me.
But when she, but I love this stuff when they're, sorry, when they're talking, the thing, the that awful thing that Wallace says to Deckard about you know, were you made to love her? Were you like, were you?
Yeah,
made to
yeah, that whole like what?
Yeah. And I think that's great because it's like either way, that's how it feels in that movie. Like that, these two characters are weirdly drawn to each other way more than they should be.
It feels like a weird response. And a response in a way to that relationship in the first movie. And,
yeah, it is. Unquestionably, I think it is. Yeah. It's, you know, because people have often said, oh, it's like it's problematic or whatever.
I agree.
So. Yeah, and I think it is a response to that.
Yeah.
But yeah, I think they do, again, they don't completely answer the question.
True. Yes. And I love that. Yeah. So, but yeah, once Kay gets taken by this underground resistance group, that comes out of nowhere in a way. And they've kind of been hinted at throughout. She, like, one of them shows up and talks to the sex worker. That's what gets her to talk to Kay in the first place. And they're like, they need Kay to join them because they are going to rise up with the help of this replicant child. She is the chosen one, essentially. It's in their eyes. She's the chosen one. And when he goes... it was a boy, and like she as he sits down, she goes, "You imagined it was you," is like the oh my god, that line.
Awful.
"You imagined it was you," is just it hit that line hits so hard.
Yeah,
it's just like because he did like he literally like he there are definitely moments where he could have thought maybe this is not me, maybe this is a coincidence at times or something or. Question the idea of whether that memory was actually his or not, but no, that's what he wanted. It's like so for it not to be real like that, and they ask him to go kill Deckard so he can't tell them where the child is, even though Deckard doesn't know where she is, and he makes a choice to do what he wants to do. And saves Deckard, and after a fight with Love, again, a very, very awesome scene, very good action scene, and takes him to see his daughter, because he's like, I'm not dealing with resistance groups or corporations anymore. You just have to want to take this guy to see his fucking daughter for the first time ever. I'm assuming he knows he's dying at that point, because he is in rough shape. Last thing he does, and then like when he dies when he lays on the stairs and looks up at this guy, that's literally the last shot of Spike in Cowboy Bebop, like frame for frame. So that was extra powerful for me at the end. I was like, oh man. I think Spike shoots at this guy before he dies. But yeah, and then the slow walk from of Deckard's character and the talk to Dr. Stellan. And she says something. He doesn't say a word. Just puts his hand on the glass, and then cut to black. I love cuts to black at the end of movies. I do. I like when I like an emotional moment, and then just ending it there for the audience, like leaving them in that emotional state at the not worrying about having to explain anything. It's just is if you are connected with these characters, this ending is going to affect you. So that's how I liked everything about it. I don't guess how you guys felt about the end. It's gorgeously shot to me, incredibly performed, just perfect in my mind. So but you guys can feel free to poke holes in if you want to. But
I love his arc. I love the way they played Roy Batty's music while he's lying in the snow. I personally choose to interpret it that Kay doesn't die. That's just my personal position.
You know what's funny? I was just thinking that, like, because I remember when I first watched Cowboy Bebop, like, early 2000s, you know, that, like, that ending of that, and then going online and, like, did Spike actually die at the end? You know, it's you know, enough there that implies that he dies, but there's enough there that there's an implication that maybe he didn't. He could have survived that.
Yeah, he could have survived. True, they could have came out and helped him afterwards. Yeah. So
I think it's another one of the many things like we've been talking about for this whole conversation. It's another one of those many things where it's sort of a little bit choose your own interpretation. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And I think it's a good story whether or not he dies, but I think it's a better story if he doesn't die personally.
Yeah.
But
yeah,
no, no.
Yeah.
Because it's too on the nose for me if he dies. But,
yeah, it kind of goes still, through that hero's journey and then just dies at the end of it. It's like, okay, I don't know if that really happened.
And all the stuff about, like, you know, the most human thing you can do is to die for someone else. And I they've kind of laid all that down, but Joy has already done that. So I think it's better that he lives, you know. But it's a pity that he won't live, but then again.
I mean, I guess we can find out in like 30 years when the next sequel is, so.
Yeah.
Yeah. My thing about this, I think, and this is probably my favorite bit of this movie, is just that, you know, the acceptance of you're not the special one, you know, but you can still do good in the world. I think as a theme goes, like,
I love that.
That is my favorite thing about this movie, is just, you know, you might think that you're going to change the world, and then that slow realization of like, oh, I'm not going to be the one to change the world, but I can still do good. And that's the biggest thing I took away from this movie in general, is just that theme.
I totally agree with that. Yeah. I agree with that.
I was so happy that he did, because it took, like, I hated the idea of a chosen one storyline at the end of that with the resistance coming back. I was not into that. So the direction they did end up going with it, I was like, thank God. But because essentially K going, yeah, fuck that. It's okay for these people just to go and live happily somewhere else. They don't, you know.
He chooses compassion on a personal level, which is a huge amount of what this story is about. Yeah.
Which is incredibly human.
Yeah, so, exactly. Yeah.
Yeah. They're basically giving him an order to go kill Deckard, and he's done with orders. So, yeah. It's beautiful. So it's a perfect arc in my.
Yeah, it is. It's so good. I love this movie so much. Mm-hmm. I've only seen it once so far because I just saw it a couple of days ago. By the way, I guess my final point on it was, I got burned real bad by The Last Jedi, and I was concerned. But then I had heard so many good things about Blade Runner 2049 that I was like, I think I'm probably going to be okay here. But also, I was just so relieved that it didn't in any way shit on the memory of one of my favorite movies. It was a real relief that everything about Blade Runner 2049 felt right to me, and it felt like a proper Blade Runner movie. And I didn't, you know, it didn't take anything away from the sort of the joy of the past. And I think that's an amazing achievement to make a sequel nearly 40 years later and nail it like that. That's incredible.
Yeah. I can't disagree with you at all on that one, Connor. I was just astounded. It's just, like I said, just somebody who really, really went through a like three-step thing with the original Blade Runner as far as like emotionally what I felt towards it. And then this sort of in the same movie brought up all of those feelings, but put it into a cohesive package. I just like, wow, this nailed it for me.
Incredible. Yeah.
It's one of my favorite sci-fi movies of all time.
Right on.
I got out of the theater the first night I saw it, and I was like, I had that thought in my mind, like, I can't, you know, like, prisoner of the moment. That's why I had to see it again.
And I know that feeling. Yeah, you're like, oh, I dare not call this a favorite yet.
Because I liked it so much in my mind. I was like, in so many ways, it was flawless in my mind. I'm like, I'm going to see it again. I'm going to have problems with it. And there are scenes I don't like as much in repeat viewings, but I don't hate them by any means. I still like them a lot. It's just, I don't, it's, and I mean, flaws in a movie make it better in my mind in some instances too. And, I think after the second time I was like, this is going to define my tastes in sci-fi stuff for a very long time. I hope it gets aped and stuff. I really do, especially its use of color and in a noir setting, but all with all the uses, the different uses of the color they still keep like that sort of noir feel to it is fantastic. It's not quite as noir as the first one I have, of course. It doesn't have a man narrating over it the entire time.
I only ever saw the final cut.
Yeah, I was going to say that's only in one of the releases, I think, that it does that. So
it's a theatrical release. Yeah. does that. But yeah.
Yeah, and Harrison Ford couldn't sound less interested in doing it.
It's not good. It's not good.
Yeah.
Final cut. The final cut's where to go, of course. But,
actually, I've seen the final cut innumerable times, but I guess whatever was the director's cut that was around in the mid 90s was the first thing I saw.
Yeah.
And then the final cut was a few years later.
Okay.
But yeah, I've never actually seen the theatrical cut. I guess because it didn't feel like that was the real movie to me.
Yeah.
They usually put that one on TV. I want to say, but it's the voiceover is not good. It makes Decker even less likable for me.
I think that whole thing of sometimes you get that thing of Harrison Ford doesn't want to be there that you've gotten nowadays. Sometimes he pops up in something and he seems like he doesn't want to be there. He really sells not wanting to be there through that voiceover thing. They called him back in to read this thing and he's just
You know the legend about it, right? The story
that
he didn't want it to be used.
Yeah. I think
he performed it in a way that he thought would make it unusable while still fulfilling his contract.
Well,
yeah,
technically not wrong. They used it.
Yeah.
Oh God. Yeah. That's yeah. It, yeah. The theatrical cut's definitely not the way to go. It's an interesting thing to watch. Just to see the progression of what the movie was supposed to be. And ultimately what it turned out to be for the initial viewing audience. But I mean, I think there's four different cuts of this. There's the theatrical, the director's, and the final, but there's also some overseas version of this where they add they mix certain parts of it together. It's kind of weird. So, but anyway, that's sort of neither here nor there.
Yeah. Also the theatrical cut doesn't have the unicorn stuff in it.
That's a big thing. So, speaking of unicorns, one last thing, shout out to Gaff. I was so excited to see Edward James Olmos again.
Yeah,
I fucking love him. Also,
nice cameo.
Yeah, he follows me on Twitter. I followed him first. He followed me back because I think he follows everyone back. So it's not a great distinction.
I'm going to Twitter right now.
It's very exciting to me whenever. Yeah, yeah. And oh my God, Gaff is so amazing in the first movie. And it's such a creation of Edward James Olmos. He came up with all this crazy stuff for Gaff, like the city speak and all. He researched it. He spent weeks in libraries. He has a part of his parentage is Hungarian. So he learned all these Chinese and Japanese and Hungarian words and put them all together to make sentences for Gaff. What an incredible performance. It was so cool to see Gaff again.
I will say this. I was actually going to bring that up before we closed up. I didn't really appreciate that he looked like Colonel Sanders, but
he's an old guy.
Yeah, just he looked was a little too on the nose for me. I was like, what is? Okay, I don't know.
He did not look like Colonel Sanders.
I think you need to watch that again.
He just had a bow tie on. I didn't make it Colonel Sanders.
I don't know. This is that mustache, the white suit. I was just like, oh man, that's a little too spot on for me. Especially with now we're going through that thing of the advertising campaign of a bunch of celebrities playing Colonel Sanders now. It's was this an odd audition tape for it?
He's way too cool to be Colonel Sanders.
Yeah, no. I didn't get that. I didn't
not at all.
I've seen it three times.
Shut it down.
Not once.
No.
Yeah.
No. No.
Yeah, sorry, as a guy who's watching Battlestar Galactica for the first time, right now, seeing that is just okay. I just. Character-wise, I like him. Appearance in this one, I was just like, man, I wish they went in a different direction.
I think it fits the original appearance.
Yeah. He looks like Gaff. Yeah.
I just mean the costume. That's what I mean appearance-wise.
I think he just had the same costume without the jacket on.
But he's wearing all white. That was my issue with it. That's what I mean. That like I said, that and the mustache and the that's where I'm seeing the Colonel Sanders thing. So, anyway.
Well, that was the institutional side of it though, wasn't it? Because he's obviously in what seems like a rest home.
Yeah.
Yeah.
They're all dressed in all white.
He just wears a bow tie because he's Gaff.
Dapper.
He's gonna give it a little extra.
Yeah. Well, that's what I mean. That little bit of, I don't know. I said that and the mustache. It just struck me a little too much after seeing Reba McEntire as Colonel Sanders. I was like, oh no, oh no, God
damn
it!
Don't bring Reba McEntire into Blade Runner.
So anyway, I think that wraps up this podcast here. We've been going for about an hour and a half here. So, real quick, you can find. I'll just do the quick plugs here. You can find us on gamesandjunk.net. We just started a new music podcast, which I literally just posted before we put this up here.
John, you want to give us the title on that?
The title of mine and Brittany's music podcast is Big Treble and Little China.
Oh, that's brilliant.
It was Brittany's idea. I can't take credit for that. I said that in the podcast. It's really good. Wow. I'm proud of her, you know.
Okay, that's a good one. Excellent. Yeah.
Yeah.
So that will be up. That'll be the first episode will be up or is up as you're listening to this. So hopefully you've already downloaded it and checked it out.
I'm gonna.
Yep. Life is Strange Before the Storm episode 3 is being worked on. I had some audio issues on my end, of course, so I'm well, we'll leave the magic behind the curtain there on that one. So
yeah, just gotta leave the magic.
Yeah, you can follow us. On all the social media things. If you go to the site, Vanessa has a lovely little box set there that you can just click on, and we're all there. Personally, you can follow me at Jason Arriola. You can follow John at John Lucero 777. And Connor, you have got some other stuff that I would like you to plug yourself because you do it so eloquently, and you're a professional speaker as well.
I mean, I'm not, when I'm in a professional capacity, I'm very slightly less foul-mouthed. Because I curse all the time when I'm casual, but
that is upsetting
for corporate purposes. Yeah, for corporate purposes, I curse a lot less. Yeah, I have my own voiceover business now. So you can go to ConnorVoice.com if you have something that you want said and you have some money that you don't want. So it needs to be, both of those things need to be true, basically, is what I'm saying here. And otherwise, you can just find me on Twitter at Conor Mahood, and I'll probably respond if you start trying to talk to me about old movies or something.
It's all it takes, really.
I think ultimately,
yeah, easy to,
I think ultimately, easy to defend me. I want to hire you and have you do a Don Pardo for the podcast.
I would be delighted. Oh, I could work on a voice and everything.
Oh boy, yeah, that would be great. So maybe it's something we should talk about eventually here because I think it's kind of fun. So anyway, that will wrap up this podcast, and we will talk at you guys next time.